Hello, this is Tom from Graphileon, and today I'm going to talk to you about importing data from CSV into Neo4j. The first thing, of course, that I have to do is to log on to Graphileon. And when I'm logged on, I can see that here I have three stores connected to it, to Graphileon. I will use the test store today, which is a Neo4j sandbox running at this address. I can test the connection. Okay, that one is okay, but the content is it still doesn't have any content. That is what you can see here. Okay, it doesn't return anything, and the schema is still empty. So no indexes or whatsoever. What you can do, of course, is to create nodes manually. So for instance, if I want to have a test node in here with a name A and store that in this test store, clone it to have node B. And then connect it of course you could do that, and then you would see that structure also here, but of course that's not what we are going to do today. We're gonna import data from a CSV. So let's delete everything, and now it is clean again. To start the import using the CSV Import Wizard, I have to go to the dashboard and start the wizard. I'm going to upload the CSV file, and I have my field separator set. I can also select, but I know that this is a this one has semicolons, and I'm going to import it to the test store. So now it extracts the columns from the CSV file, and I know that I have a number of them that are in date format. Date, and here is also a date. The next step is creating the different entity types. Let's remember that we have to create five entity types: car, brand, country, person, and organization. And each of those entity types, which correspond to labels in Neo4j, they have an identifying property. So for instance, for the person, we will take the email. For the car, we will take the license plate. For the brand, we will use the brand name. For the country, we will use the country column. And for the organization, we will take the organization column. So let's do that. So we have person. We have brand, we have car, we have country, and we have organization. And now, for instance, for the person, I have my email property, which comes from the email column and which is the identifying property. I also have my name, which will I get from my first name, and I have my birth date, which comes from the birth date column. So this defines my the properties for the person nodes. I'm also going to do that for the rest of the nodes. Okay, on the next screen we can do we can define all the relationship types, but let's first have a look at the mapping that the wizard already created. So here I have my the URL of my file name, the store I want to import it in, and here I have the different node types that that have been created. So for instance, here the email is the identifying property for the node type person, and it is a string. And from this here, once I have created the relationships, I can also I can start doing the actual import. Let's rapidly look at the relationships we want to create. So from this part here at the top, we're going to create the car is of a brand, so these are those two columns, license plate and brand. We're also going to create the brand produced in, which we are using these two columns for. We are also going to create the person works for an organization. And that is, of course, the person and the organization with a property that indicates since when the person works for the organization. Okay, I can say, okay, my person, organization, works for. And the next step we are going to do, that was the car. Is of brand, and we are going to create the brand to country is produced in. And we said that for the organization, the person organization works for a relationship, we are going to add a property that we get from the works since column. Now the CSV import mapping has been extended, so here I see already a couple of the relationships that I want to create. Now let's look at the next block. These are these organizations, and here know that I'm using a rel type column. This is one of the two special columns that we have in the CSV. It indicates the type of relationship, and here I have two identifying columns, the country name and the person email name. And in this case, in the owns relationship, which indicates a relationship between the person and the car and the date since when that car is owned. So I'm going to create those two relationships now. I have my person and I have my car. And if I check this this checkbox, it displays the relationships that that are here in this rel type column. This is one, and of course I also have to add the property since the date column, and I had the other relationship, the person to the country, and has the nationality. There is no property here. Now for the third block of relationships, these are special in another way. As you can see, these are relationships between nodes of the same type. So here a person knows another person. We have here a car that had a collision with another car, and we have two persons that are married. So for that we use a second special column. So besides the rel type, we have the ID2, which is a copy of the ID, and that allows me to create those relationships, that basically the self-referencing, as you can see here in the metadata schema, the self-referencing, the self-pointing relationships. Let's do that. So I have here my person, and here person as well. It will default the normal column, but I am using now the ID2, and I filter it, and I have my married to relationship, and with all the relationships that it knows the collided with, and we have a date. So here married since the date, and I have the relationship person. Knows date, and I have a relationship car to another car, which comes from the ID2 column, collided with collision date, and all the relationships are added to the import template, which is basically the recipe for the rest of the wizard, which creates dynamically all the necessary queries and indexes. Now the only thing that's left is to run the importer. We have created the recipe or the import mapping, and let's see what happens. Okay, it creates the constraints which are necessary and the different entity types. It does some housekeeping. It has updated the nodes or loaded the nodes, and now it creates the relationships. We can change the layout so it's a little bit more what we were expected, and here you can see the metadata schema of everything that has been created. If I now go to my Neo4j browser and do a match M return N, I see that all my nodes are there. I have my organization nodes. I have here, I have my license plate. I have my car brands, I have my countries, I have the relationships, works for with the date. I have everything that I expected to find. And of course, I can also go back to Graphileon and then access this data using Graphileon. So let's just duplicate this one and go to the default dashboard. And then let's see what we have here in the test store, default query. And see that the same data is available here. Of course, you still have to need to do some styling, but the data is there where we expect it to be. So far, we just talked about importing data into a graph. The next couple of minutes, I will focus on another graphy aspect of Graphileon, which is building application on top of graphs in a very graphy way. As you may have seen that, okay, there are many components of this entire wizard. We have here a progress window, we have a graph visualization, we had the import mapping, we have grids here with the grids that are connected. I can do previous relationship. This is really a kind of application that we built in Graphileon itself. And if you look at what we have in our, there is this app library of all kinds of examples. And one of the examples that we created was this CSV import wizard. And it has been installed, you see it here as the top. And if you open it, it allows you to look at the view, to look at the logic, the internal logic of this application. And well, this is of course, it's also a graph because we consider applications as, let's say, functions that trigger other functions. So we have here, we have different components, we have a layout, we have a logo panel, we have an IO function, we have a grid, we have a form, and we have also all these circular things, the blue things that are, those are queries. So for instance, if you can edit it and look at it, well, there is no cipher statement in here. So here, this is a Neo4j cipher statement that creates dynamic cipher, and all these functions are related to each other. So for instance, if this query executes successfully, it triggers another, in this case, an iterator function which executes a number of statements. And then also this on each iteration, it executes another cipher and then it loops. And eventually, when you see all these, it creates the different groups of relationships that we have talked about. And then from time to time in an iteration, it sends stuff to this Y-files view, which is a network visualization. And there is where you see the graph being built up, the blue nodes that you will see. So if you are interested in this, please have a look at the app wizard, the app library, in which you find a number of examples that that can help you start building applications on top of a graph database, bearing in mind that the applications themselves are also graphs. So this was a short introduction to the new CSV import wizard that we have. I hope you enjoyed it, and thank you for watching.